Welcome to the television ministry of Souls Harbor Tabernacle. We are located in the shadow of beautiful Crowder's Mountain, 271 Camp Rotary Road, Gastonia, North Carolina. Now be blessed by the anointed ministry of Pastor James Chambers and Church.
Well, praise the Lord. So good to be with you tonight. This is Pastor Chambers coming to you on this Saturday night TV telecast. I want to invite you to be with us at church in the morning. Our service starts at 11. Sunday night service starts at 6, and we have Wednesday night service at 7 o'clock, and we'd like to remind you that we stream all of our services live on the Souls Harbor Tabernacle at Gastonia, North Carolina. You'll find our Facebook there. You've got all the events, all the schedules for our meetings and our services. They're all there. You can look it up anytime you'd like to. Also, all the TV programs and all the church services for this year basically is on our Facebook page, so you can go back and look at any you missed. We had some exciting services this year. Had a couple of singing services with the Southland Singers, Roland King, and they're real good. If you'd like to back up and look at those, you could. And then also we had a camp meeting just a couple of weeks ago with Brother Chandler from Alabama, and had some more good services, so you could look at all of them. We'd be glad to have you view them at your leisure. Amen. Also want to tell you about a great church of ours in Dallas, North Carolina. Brother Eric Quinn, his wife Arlene, a pastor there and work for the Lord there. And they'd be so glad to see you at 11 o'clock in the morning, 6 o'clock tomorrow night, and 7 o'clock on Tuesday night. And then also, if you drove up the road above Shelby to Mooresboro, you'd find another great Souls Harbor church. Brother Chuck Poole and his wife Joyce labor for the Lord there, and they'd be so glad to see you. Their service times are like the other two churches on Sunday, 11 o'clock and 6 o'clock on Sunday night, and then they have their midweek service on Thursday, and again, ours is on Wednesday. And again, Betty and I would love to see you at any of our services, and I'd love to hear you went to the Mooresboro Church or to the Dallas Church. We're all in this together and working for the Lord. You'll hear the word preached, and I'm sure you'll feel welcome in any of our services. Amen. So good to be with you tonight. Call that number on the screen. Talk to Donnie. Let him know your prayer request tonight, and he'll send those right over to me after the end of the program. I'm already in prayer for you, but we'll pray personally. I called all those things that come in. And last week was a busy week. He had a lot of calls last week, more than normal, and I took every one of them to the Lord and prayed for them separately, and I will again, and Donnie does too, and we'll just believe God to meet your need. It's so good to have you tonight. Dedicate the singing tonight to all three churches, and the pastors and the wives, and it's just such a privilege to be here tonight, and it is a privilege to have our wife, Betty Chambers, going to sing for us tonight, and I'm sure she'll be a blessing. I have a lot of folks ask me to get her to sing. I mean, we had a couple ladies write me and tell me to get her out of the closet. Well, she's not been in a closet, but she likes to sing when she feels like singing. And so she's going to sing for you tonight. And I dedicate this to all the folks who love to hear her sing. Worship with Sister Chambers as she sings at this time.
Like a storm, it cuts a path. Oh, it breaks your will, and you feel like that. Think you're lost, but you're not lost on your own. Oh, but you're not alone. He will stand by you. He will help you through when you've done all you can do and you can't cope. He will dry your eyes. He will fight your fight. He will hold you tight, and he won't let go. It hurts his heart to see you cry. He knows this darkest part of life. Oh, it finds us all, but we're too small. the rain. Oh, but when it rains, he will stand by you. He will help you through when you've done all you can do. When you can't cope, he will dry your eyes. He will fight your fight. He will hold you tight, and he won't let go. Oh, he will stand by you. He will help you through when you've done all you can do. When you can't cope, he will dry your eyes. He will fight your fight. He will hold you tight, and he won't let go. No, he won't let go.
Praise the Lord. Amen. I ought to be able to get a witness from that tonight. Anybody here, I know that he'll fight your fight. Amen. He'll hold to you, and he won't let go. Precious song there, Sister Chambers. We thank you for that song tonight. Pray that you were blessed by that song. Continue to call the number on the screen there. Talk to Brother Donnie. He'll be there to take your call tonight. And God will be there to hear you call. Amen. Last week we had some from further away call in. And God knows where you're at tonight. He knows everything that's going on. And he'll be there to meet your need. And so if you would, just call that number on the screen. We'll be so glad to hear from you tonight. Amen. We'd like to talk to you just for a moment to take that address down that's on the screen. Write us next week. If you've been thinking about supporting this ministry, it has been very low this month and probably the record low for the year, unless things have changed in the last day or two from when we pre-recorded this broadcast. Amen. It is pre-recorded, but Donnie's by the phone live to take your call. We're doing all we can to make this as effective as we can and to make every move count for the Lord. Amen. And we feel like we're doing the best thing we can do here by taping some of these and reaching out to you. But we need to hear from you. If you could write us this week, if you've been thinking about helping us, all gifts, all sizes are appreciated. Dollars, $2, $10, whatever you'd like to send or more. We'd be so glad. I won't promise you that you're going to get 1,000 back if you give to this ministry, because God didn't tell me that, and he'd have to for me to tell you that. But I will tell you that he said he'd bless those that bless you. So if you bless this ministry, then God is obligated to bless you, and he will. Amen. You live a holy life, shun the wrong, and do what's right, and God will take care of you, I promise you. But we'd love to hear from you this week. If you can't give a love gift, write us anyway. It's encouraging to get mail from all over. No people are listening to us, but at this moment in time, it would be real timely if you prayed about it and God impressed you to send a gift to this ministry. We would certainly appreciate it. Call that number on the screen there and talk to Donnie and enjoy the singing. Sister Chambers comes back to sing another song for us tonight at this time.
My boat of life sails on the troubled sea. Ever there's a wind in my sail. But I have a friend who watches over me when the breeze turns into a gale. I know the master of the wind. I know the maker of the rain. And he can calm the storm, make the sun shine again. I know the master of the wind. Sometimes I feel like an eagle to the sky. Among the peaks my soul can be found. But an unexpected storm may drive me from the heights. It brings me low, but it never brings me down. I know the master of the wind. I know the maker of the rain. He can calm those storms. He'll make the sun shine again. I know the master of the wind. I know the master of the wind. I know the maker of the rain. He can calm the storm, make the sun shine again. I know the master of the wind.
Well, praise the Lord. I'm glad I know him. Amen. Just thinking about some of the things Brother Chamley told us the other night. I believe when he preached at Brother Chuck's church, he talked about ship sailing, and he talked about how sailboats were, that they were driven by the wind. I want you to know he's the master of the wind, and he sails my boat, and he drives my boat, and he pilots my ship. Don't co-pilot, amen, he pilots my ship, amen. If we co-pilot and I have to drive sometimes, every time I do, I'll get in a mess. But as long as I ride in the back seat and he rides in the front seat, I'll land safely on port to sail no more. Jesus pilots my boat. Amen.
Right.
Aren't you glad? Amen. Don't you love him tonight? Call that number on the screen. Testify. If you know the master of the wind, or if he's ever held you and kept you, like her first song said, and held you tight and not let you go, testify to Donnie. He'd like to hear it. Amen. He'll write it down and mention it to me. Amen. So good to be with you tonight. Want to go to the Word of God tonight for the time that's left. Do pray for this ministry. Pray that God would bless it, that he has, for we're in our 19th year. Been coming up here for 19 years, and God has supplied the need. The first couple of years, we really struggled to pay for it and didn't know just absolutely for sure that we were in, had the mind of God to be here, because it didn't look like we was going to get to stay. But God spoke to me about asking people to stand with us at $10 a month. And we've had a number of people to do that. Got some that do more than that. And we appreciate it, because you make up for some that don't. Amen. But it has just supplied the need. And for 17 years, I've given money to it, but because I wanted to. I've not had to give any money. God has supplied the need for our 17th year. And I have no reason for me to doubt him that he's going to continue to do it through people just like you. We'd love to hear from you. In the book of 2 Kings, chapter 4, I want to read just a portion of a little story, and we'll elaborate on it in the time that we have left. Verse 8 says, "And it fell on a day that Elijah passed to Shunem, where was a great woman, and she constrained him to eat bread." She asked him to eat, encouraged him to eat with them. "And so it was that as oft as he passed by, he turned in thither to eat bread. And she said unto her husband, Behold, now I perceive that this is a holy man of God, which passeth by us continually. Let us make a little chamber, I pray thee, on the wall, and let us set him there a bed and a table and a stool and a candlestick. And it shall be when he comes to us that he shall turn in thither. And it fell on a day that he came thither, and he turned into the chamber and lay there." I want to stop right there and maybe elaborate a little bit more on it, but right there and just say it's time. We, the church, need to be laying foundations and setting things up for God to bless us. Amen. This woman didn't know how bad she'd need this man of God, and it was good to know that he was a resident in her house, and he was there to take care of her, but later on, she needed him, and he wasn't there. She placed her need in that room and went for him and come back, and God answered her prayer. We just need to lay a foundation. The Bible said, Lay up your treasures in heaven where moth and rust does not corrupt. Amen. And thieves don't break through and steal. Laying up our treasures in heaven, laying a foundation. That's probably what I'm talking about tonight in its entirety. Father, bless this word. Use it, encourage it for your glory. And we'll thank you for everything you've done. We'll magnify you and praise you in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Talk for the few minutes of time that we have left on the subject laying up a spiritual foundation. We do that with prayers, mainly in prayers and study and seeking God and reading the Word. But sometimes the physical acts that we commit causes God to remember us later on in life when we need God to answer a prayer for us. The scripture says, keep on casting your bread upon the water. It'll come back not many days hence. And I believe that. I've lived by that. Nearly 50 years of serving the Lord and over 40 some years of preaching the gospel. I have lived by that, that if I keep praying and I keep living right, keep doing what's right, keep paying my tithes. You don't hear many people say much about that. Keep paying my tithes. Keep giving to God tithes of my time and my health and my knowledge. Everything that I have, give to him first. And he said all these other things would be added. So all the other things sum up everything you need, everything I need. This woman was not aware. She actually made a testimony that sounded like she didn't need nothing, you know. Elijah called Gehazi's servant, and he told him to call this Shunammite woman in to where they was at. And when he had called her, she stood before him. And he said unto him, say now unto her, behold, thou hast been careful with us all this care. What is it to be done for thee? What can we do for you? Wouldest thou be spoken for to the king or to the captain of the host? And she answered, I dwell among my own people. Pretty much translated, just says that she took care of herself. She made sure everything was all right. Didn't need any money. She had money to ask her husband to build him a room onto their house, and he did, and God had already been taking care of her. And, you know, but he looked at her to see what he could do for her. He said, what then is to be done for her? And Gehazi's servant answered, verily she have no child, and her husband is old. Amen. She has no child, and her husband is past the year bearing age, if she was that he was, is what Gehazi was saying. Doesn't look very possible, but she'd like to have a child. And so he said unto her, then it is no to be done for her. It is to be done for her. And Gehazi answered, verily she have no child. And he said, call her. And when she called her, she stood in the door, and he said, about this season, or 9 months, or in the season of life, according to the time of life, thou shalt embrace a son. And she said, nay, my Lord, thou man of God, do not lie unto thy handmaiden. And the woman conceived and bare a son at that season that Elijah had said unto her according to the time of life. Amen. And we'll stop there. It goes into another story. A need came for that child, but you know, she was certainly blessed. Amen. I'm telling you, God, you know, has blessed women past childbearing age. God has blessed men that was passed by childbearing age and blessed them with children, because sooner or later we have to realize they all gifts of God anyway. I don't care, you know, how good looking you are, how beautiful you are as a woman. I'm telling you, if you have a beautiful child that's healthy and well, God gave it to you. And she realized that. That's why she said, don't play with me. Man of God, don't lie to me. If you're not going to let this come to pass, if this is not going to happen, don't get my hopes up. He said, just set your clock, and when the time is up, then you will have a child. God will bless you. But you know the story. It wasn't long after that. Verse 18 said, when the child was grown, it fell on a day that he went out to his father, to the reapers. And he said unto his father, my head, my head. And he said to a lad, carry him to his mother. And when he had taken him and brought him to his mother, He sat on her knees till noon. Must not have been a real big child. He was grown. He was old enough to work in the field with his dad, but he was still little enough to sit on his mama's knee. Amen. And then he died. And she went up and laid him on the bed for the man of God and shut the door upon him and went out. She called her husband and said, "Send me, I pray thee, one of the young men and one of the asses that I may run to the man of God." Amen. I'm telling you, you got it right. Brother Chamberlain and I were talking the other day about people having needs. If you've done all you know to do and you're standing on the promises of God, you've been faithful to God, I can tell you tonight, He'll be faithful to you. If you've been faithful to God, He will be faithful to you. You have every right to run to the man of God and say, "Preacher, pray for me. Preacher, I have this problem. I have this need." And she did just that. Amen. "That I may run to the man of God and come again." And he said, "Wherefore wilt thou go to him today? It is neither new moon nor Sabbath." And she said, "It shall be well." He pretty much let her know she didn't even know where he was at. You don't know what season he's at in his life, where he's at. I'm going to go to him. Then she saddled an ass and said to her servant, "Drive and go forward. Slack not thy riding for me, except I bid thee." Don't slow down on my part. Amen. I got to get to this man of God. Because she knew. No doubt, she knew. It came back to her. Here's a man of God that didn't have a place to stay. My husband and I took care of him. We gave him food every time he came through our way. And at the moving of God, I feel like she talked to her husband to build him a room. They built him a place, and he stayed there. It was probably just a good feeling how this man of God, she said, "I perceive that he is a man of God." And it was probably a credit to her to know that when her husband was in part of the house, that she had a man of God staying in the same house. And so it paid off for her because she got a son that she could have probably never had without a miracle, without God working for her. She had a son. The son came along and he began to grow, and I'm sure he was the pride of his mom and dad's life. Amen. They loved this child that God had given them. Working in the field, he had some kind of a sickness attack him. Most Bible scholars think he probably had a head stroke or a heat stroke because he complained about his head. "My head, my head." But his mama holding him on her knees when the servant, the father, had to bring him to his mother, she held him on his knees till noon, and then he died. Amen. Early in the morning out working, he was nearly dead. She held him until he died. Knew there wasn't nothing she could do for him. Took him and laid him on the man of God's bed that she had had her husband to build, and went riding for this man. Elijah saw her, asked Gehazi to ask her if things are well. And her little boy, dead at home, she said, "It's well." He asked him specifically, "Is it okay with your husband?" "It's well." "Is it okay with you?" "It's well." "Is it okay with your son?" "It is well. But I need you to come to my house." He sent Gehazi, and Gehazi did what he told him to do, or what he felt was right to do, but there was still no life in the child. So she got Elijah to come to her house with much pleading and much endeavor. She got him to come to her house. And you know the story. She went and came to the man of God. And did I desire a son from you? Did I ask you for a son? Did I say, "Do not deceive me"? Didn't I tell you, "Don't play with me. Don't give me a child and then take it away from me"? "I'm serious," she said. "He's at home. Wasn't any life in him when I left, but if you'll come back and pray for him, he will live." And so he did that. Then he said to Gehazi, "Gird up thy loins and take my staff in thine hand and go thy way. If thou meet any man, salute him not. Just keep going. Lay my staff on the face of this child." The mother of the child said, "As the Lord liveth, as thy soul liveth, I will not leave thee." And he arose and followed her. She was glad that Gehazi was going to do what the man of God said, But she wasn't taking no chance. She had rode hard to get to this man of God, and she knew that she had laid the foundation. I've been good to this man of God. I took care of him when he didn't have anybody, took care of him. My husband and I supplied for him. You shouldn't look at everything you do for God like God's just going to give it right back to you. But I'm telling you, he did tell us to give, and it shall be given unto you. He did tell us if we'll follow his command and do everything we can to help one another, that when the need, when the tide turns, that it's our house, it's our child, it's our son, we got every right. Betty and I went through a situation a long time ago, 16 years ago to be exact, when our baby girl had the only grandson we got, and she took sick. She had kidney failure, and they took her to Charlotte, telling us that they couldn't treat her for the problem she had in Gastonia. They were moving her to Charlotte, and it was terrible. You know, from about 1 o'clock in the day to about 6 o'clock at night, she swelled up about 100 pounds, all fluid. It looked like she was about to bust. Blood pressure was going out the roof, and we went over there, and we got on the phone. We had cell phone. Betty got on one, and I got on the other. We called preachers. We called radio stations where they had prayer lines, everything we could, because we believed that it was will of God to heal her. 16 years later, she is off dialysis. They put her on it for the rest of her life. She's off of it, been off of it since about a year or 6 months after she was put on it, when the doctor said she'd be put on it. But our life for him is worth something. You got to realize when you're living for the Lord, when you're praying and seeking God and going to church every time the doors is open, you're laying up treasures in heaven. You're not sending up boards. They don't need nothing we got down here in that city. But you are laying up treasures, amen. And when you need it, I mean, people save money for that reason. When a need comes that they got money, they're so glad they got $200 or $300 or $2,000 or $3,000 laid back waiting for that need. I can tell you, it's a good feeling to have a little money when bills come in, when things come to you, when something breaks that costs you $1,000 or $2. It's nice to have that money, but I'd rather have Jesus, as Donnie sings, than anything I know. And I'd rather know that I had done all that I need to do. When I go to him in prayer, I don't worry about him saying, well, if you'd have gave to that ministry, if you'd have paid your tithes, if you'd have been faithful to church, if you hadn't have laid out of church, I don't have to worry about none of that because I haven't done none of those things. And if you have, I'm not scolding you, but I'm telling you tonight that what you need to do is turn to Jesus and lay that foundation, and when the need arises, he'll be there for you. Be faithful to him, he'll be faithful to you. As we close, let us pray. Father, I pray tonight that you take this message short. Don't think it's been scattered, been to the point, Lord. If we lay the foundation, when we have a need, we can go to God in prayer like I'm doing for all those that call in right now, that the need will be met, and we'll give you all the praise and all the glory in Jesus' name. Amen. Good night, everybody. Meet us back next Saturday night at the same time, 9:30. And we can come into your house one more time. God bless you. Good night.
Thank you for joining us on the telecast. Pastor Chambers, wife Betty, and entire congregation welcome you to any of our exciting services. Sunday school, 9:45 a.m. Morning worship, 11 a.m. Sunday evening, 6 p.m. and Wednesday at 7. Tune in next time.